The whole countryside is one vast graveyard, not merely from the First World War, but from all the other wars in which Britain has taken part in Flanders. Should Britain join Europe? The question is meaningless in a place like this. The argument about Britain joining the common market is not about the price of butter. It's about the price that all the leaders of Western Europe are prepared to pay to put European civil wars behind them and to create the institutions which will enable them to shape their future in the world in unity. This is a time for greatness. If the nations of Western Europe will rise to the challenge which faces them, then the case for Britain joining the common market is an overwhelming one. The War Memorial in my constituency of Dundee looks out over all sorts of people affected by the common market, industrial workers, housewives, as well as hill farmers and fishermen, for whom my successor as Common Market Minister, Geoffrey Rippon, brought back safeguards this week. Now the terms of entry are known. Now MPs can consult their constituents. What do mine say to me?
What is it going to cost us? This is a point we've got to ask. What is our cost of living going to be like? And there's no use having £1,000 a week if it's going to cost you £900 to live off it.
But in the near future, Britain goes into the common market and the fishing rights on our boat and the East Coast aren't recognised, our boat's going to become a ghost town.
Mr. Thomson, entry to the common market will mean an escalation of the Cold War again, which will mean an increase in the arms bill in this country, a direct threat to world peace.
In the common market, there's no tariffs. Where will the workers at Dundee and the Timex stand when the tariff barriers to the watch industry get taken away?
I believe there are good answers to these anxious questions. I want to show why the common market offers us the best chance of a higher quality of life. I began by asking industrial leaders and talking to an economic expert, Andrew Schonfield.
I suspect that the large number of people who opt against the common market because they think the present is cozy and they'd like to continue with it don't take account of the fact that our troubles today, and here I include slow economic growth, rather higher unemployment for a long time under both governments than the other nations of Western Europe, that these things relate to a process that's been going on really for most of this century. And what we who want to go into the common market are after is to change that process.
Long term, there is no future for British industry unless we're in the common market. It's quite impossible in this day and age to lay down plant for production of any single commodity you can think of on the basis of 50 million consumers. If you can lay down a plant to provide for the requirements of 250 million consumers, there you get the benefit of size and you get the reduction in the cost of the final product. And anybody that is left out, as we would be if we do not join the common market, would just see our business and trade dwindle away.
Look at the alternative if we don't go in. If we don't go in, we just are a small island on our own, not associated with anybody, not in any big area where we can sell and use those skills, manufacturing, selling, designing and so on that we have. I believe, I've got a lot of faith in this country, I believe that we can produce as good a car, or if not a better car, than the Germans, the Italians or the French. But it's not going to be easy. I'm under no illusions about this, but I think it's a challenge that no one in this country dare resist for the future, because if we don't, the alternative is slowly sinking into obscurity.
When you reach out and think in terms of the next 30 years, space travel and everything of that kind, this country could not possibly finance it, but Europe could finance it.
Lord Kirton, why is Courtauld's expanding so fast here in Calais inside the common market?
To take advantage of the dynamic market of nearly 200 million people which the common market provides. Well, over the last 10 years, we have spent a lot of money in Britain, particularly on textile processes, because we feel inside the common market we can have a very big market indeed. We have not yet got the full benefit of all that we have been doing in capital expenditure. If we stay outside the common market, then we shall put nearly all our new capital expenditure, not in Britain, but where the market, where the growth is, inside the common market. This, in the long term, would be not a good thing all the textile industry.
Do you feel we have some competitive advantages that we can take with us into the common market?
If we, you know, using the Shakespearean adage, if to ourselves we are but true, yes, we've got enormous advantages. If we have skill, energy, determination, we can flourish. If not, disaster.
Quite frankly, unless we get into the common market, within 20 years, we'll be an offshore island of the European continent, looking inward all the time, and our markets throughout the world will have vanished, disappeared. And apart from the fact that at the moment people are screaming them out, they may have to pay a little bit more for kippers or butter, when that day comes, they won't have the money to buy even the kippers or the butter at any price.
Butter from New Zealand, like other vital Commonwealth issues, has now been safeguarded. New Zealand says Britain has stood by her and she can face the challenge.
All we say is, will we accept that if you are a stronger trading partner, that's surely good for us. It's good for the rest of the world. It's good for the Commonwealth countries.
But how can Britain be strong if she has to accept such a big share of the community budget on her balance of payments?
But people have frightened us. The anti-marketeers have frightened us with ideas about the size of this entrance fee. If you add it all up in a realistic fashion, what you're going to have to sacrifice is, to be careful about it, the probable growth of our exports in 1 year, the amount of increase in our exports in one good year will have to go into this entrance fee. From then on, we're on our own, and I take it that we're going to grow faster, and if we grow even moderately faster, we shall be many, many hundreds of millions of pounds richer at the end of 5 to 10 years.
Just look at what the common market has done for the rate of growth of the community, and how for 12 years now it has left us further and further behind. In 1958, real wages in the community were £2 below Britain. Today they are £5 higher. Argue as you will about statistics, the message is unmistakable.
Well, we're doing pretty well, I must admit. I guess we got an annual increase of about 15 or 17%. I guess we have the advantage of having a strong platform in the common market, and that enables us to penetrate in the British markets as well. But on the other hand, I think that British firms could have been in the same position when they were penetrating in Europe.
This prosperity is a great deal dependent on the common market.
The situation at the moment is very good. We have to build about 14 tankers, 8 in Amsterdam and 6 in Rotterdam. And we are so busy to do this job that we need more workers, I think about 500.
In all the countries of the community, the success story is similar. Listen to the managing director of a Dutch steel firm.
The Dutch market would never have been large enough to absorb the quantities which are necessary for the modern steel industry in order to produce high quality products at a low price. Since we entered into the common market, our production is about 10 times as large as it was in 1952. We sell about 25% of our production on the Dutch market, 25% to the other markets of the steel community, which means that it is 100 times as large as in 1952. Yes.
I do not claim greater growth will happen automatically in Britain or overnight, but I know no other way to get it. And I believe we have the enterprise to seize the opportunity. Not only business, but the ordinary worker will benefit in lower unemployment and higher wages. Jack van der Poel is an active member of the Dutch labour movement. His standard of living has gone up because of the common market. Yet when Holland entered the common market, like Britain, it faced higher food prices. I reminded him of this as he and his brother-in-law Frank took me sailing.
Yeah, that's right. At that time, the wages also went up. And if I remember the figures well, that the prices went up about 4% a year and the wages went up about 8 to 9% a year. So our buying power is doubled in the last 10 years. That's true. About the holidays, we get everybody gets 6% of their yearly salary as a holiday allowance. Above the paying during the holiday time is about a month's salary. And the length of your holiday varies from 15 working days to 25 working days. That depends upon your position and your age.
And yes. Does that include public holidays like Christmas and Easter?
No, that's besides that, yes.
And Frank, does that apply to office workers as well as to industrial workers?
Yes, that's the same thing. Everybody who's employee at minimum becomes 6% of yearly allowance as a vacation bonus, yes. And in some industries it's more, but as an average it's a minimum of 6%.
These are some of the reasons why I've not found a single labour movement in the Six which regrets joining the market. They want the British and Scandinavian unions in with them to win even better benefits. They've had 12 years' experience of the market, and they like it.
It's brought a greater variety of articles in the shops. You can buy things that you didn't see in the shops before you went into the common market.
Can I add to that? I think that you can... say that we have not only a greater variety of goods, but that also the prices of those goods not only remain stable, but slightly become lower, as a result of, as I see it, concentration of industries there where it's cheaper and mass production is possible. Mm-hmm. I think of washing machines from Italy. You spoke of washing machines. We have very much clothing from Germany,
yes.
And you know, those things you're wearing, and these things from Italy, and that sort of things.
Yes, that's right.
Fruits and vegetables. Mm-hmm. Those there where the sun is, you know, our vegetables grow under glass, and glass is a very expensive way of growing vegetables and fruits, and
yes.
In that way the greater market enables us to buy things we hadn't before, and at the same or lower price.
For the Van der Poels, it is the standard of living, not the cost of living, which counts, as it would for the people of Dundee if we go into the market. Overall, the cost of living will go up by an extra 1% per year, less than it rose in a month recently, and the new opportunities for higher earnings would more than cancel that out. Dundee workers have plenty of experience from the past of low prices, but even lower wages. But these jute workers face the immediate closure of their mill. What worries them is whether they're going to have any wages at all.
You were way back to the 1930s again, way back when my father and mother and them were working for full wages and everything like that, and you had nothing to eat. You had to go back at that time.
Yeah.
I want to work. Could you get me a job when I leave here? No. You can't get some of the younger people a job.
If we were going into the common market just now, I mean, Dundee would be in dire straits, wouldn't they?
Well, Dundee is in dire straits already with the decline of one of Britain's traditional industries, but the way the common market works would make things better, not worse.
Because the common market is called a market, people forget that it was originally conceived of as being at least as much a club as a market. And a club means that if one of the members gets into trouble, the collective resources of the whole group are to be put at its disposal in order to get it right. It is a sort of mutual aid society.
But what does happen inside the community if an industry is in decline and people are being paid off after years of service, as is happening in Dundee? Take Hans Gerhardt's in Limburg.
5 years ago, I was a miner. I worked underground for 17 years, and I earned a lot of money. When the pits were closing down, I got the opportunity to get a retraining as a technician. That was paid by the common market. After I passed my examination, I got a job as a technician at a chemical work. My salary now is a lot less than before, but the common market raises up my salary to almost the same level as before.
The common market has helped Hans Gerhardt to change his way of work, but it hasn't changed his way of life. What the prosperity of the common market has done is to enable the Dutch to live the traditional way of life to the full.
Wees gegroet, Maria, vol van genade, de Heer is met u gezegend, gezegend onder de vrouwen en gezegend is Jezus de vrucht van uw schoot. Namen de Vader en de Zoon en de Heilige Geest af. Meneer Pistoor, ja, ik ga het. Burgemeester.
In Britain, people fear the market will destroy their sense of national identity, and they will be swallowed up in some anonymous Europeanism. But as this border village engages in its age-old ritual of marksmanship, there's not much sign of them suffering from the tyranny of the faceless bureaucrats of Brussels. Wherever I travelled in the countries of the Six, I found the quality of life enriched, not eroded, by the higher living standards of the common market.
I feel a Dutchman now, and just the same as 20 years before when common market started. I can't see any difference now in those 20 years between me, my being a Dutchman.
For Lucy's father, the stamps he collects in the picturesque street market reflect the fact that national independence is out of date.
I think all over the world, all countries are coming together in big blocks. And if one country didn't like to go in one of the blocks, you know, then you've lost your own side.
But some fear that building a bigger Western bloc will escalate the Cold War. Western Europe is, after all, only one half of Europe. I put this to the German Chancellor, Willy Brandt.
I experienced, when I was foreign minister, the failure of the last attempt to enlarge the common market. It failed in December 67, as you well remember. And that then led to 2 years of stagnation within the existing community. This time, I think it would be worse. It would lead to much more of a stagnation and frustration for the existing community, and it would lead to a series of quarrels, which would be bad not only for the economic process of working closer together, but also it would be worse for our would be bad for our relations with the United States, and. For the process, where possible, to reduce tensions.
There is no doubt that Europe is not playing a real part in economic, but much more in political affairs in the world. It has a choice to remain divided and to play no real part, or to unite and to play a real part. That means to be a partner to the free world and not a satellite of one or the other big powers. This, so I believe, is the fate of most of the European countries which still have officially a sovereignty, but very often and in decisive question can't make use of it.
Well, what about sovereignty? We will join the European Parliament in Strasbourg, and I hope our national governments are going to speak with a more united political voice. But we're not being committed to a political federation, nor will the House of Commons be turned into a rubber stamp.
No, there will not be such a danger. British Parliament, of course, will remain in the same position it has been before to control the British government, and the British government will take care of Britain's interest within the Council in Brussels. And if Parliament doesn't like what the government does there, they will say this as they do in other countries, in any case in our country.
Let's take Rolls-Royce. Where today is the future of Rolls-Royce being determined? In the United States of America by their Congress, in which we have no voice of any kind whatsoever. But they are going to determine whether Rolls-Royce goes on or not. So there's not much sovereignty at this moment of time as far as Rolls-Royce is concerned. And let me take another example. Let us take the boardroom in Detroit of the Ford Motor Company. They have to invest, say, £30 million in a plant in Europe. Where will that decision be made? By the British? Not on your life. In a boardroom in Detroit with no British voice present. The choice is a simple one. Let the Americans or the Russians or somebody else determine the future of Britain industry, or at least let's have a voice in determining it ourselves. So sovereignty is a myth in terms of the arguments that are now being used by people who should know better.
Today, the full package of terms became clear. Until this moment, it has been impossible to come to a final decision. I simply want to say, as the minister who began these negotiations, that in my personal view, these are terms which I would have recommended a Labour cabinet to accept. The anti-marketeers say that the alternative to the common market is to go on as we are. Well, the present situation is grim enough, goodness knows, but project that forward for 30 years and you have a recipe for disaster. That's why I believe that we have no choice but to join Europe now. In that way, we will ensure the best chance of higher living standards for our people, the best chance of Britain being able to make a positive contribution to a more peaceful world, and above all, the best chance to give our children and our children's children the quality of life which we seek for them.